Hello everyone, welcome to the mind map series, and we will talk about this particular mind map, which is a relatively smaller one, electromagnetic waves. First of all, we'll break the terms. What are these waves? Actually, we have talked about waves in the previous classes, and we already know. But what is this electromagnetic wave? Electro and magnetic means the things that are going to oscillate over here are not particles. This is not a mechanical wave, non-mechanical wave. It means in mechanical waves, there are some physical particles which are oscillating. But in this electromagnetic wave, these are not the particles which oscillate. It's just that the intensity of electric and magnetic fields which are oscillating. For example, let's say the magnetic field currently looks like something like this. Wait just a second. Over. This is the, let's say, electric field, the intensity, electric field intensity, and this is, let's say, distance x. Now the curve looks something like this, right? Yes, the curve looks something like this, and it may extend further. But after some time, if it happens that, let's say, this position looks something like this, and now the intensity of the electric field at individual positions looks something like this. Just a second. Now, over the individual intensities, the intensity has varied, but what you see is basically the shape of the curve, the shape of the electric field versus x graph. It was this, it remained as this one, but it has changed its position. What do we call such type of things? This is nothing but a wave, right? You notice that a wave is simply, in the mechanical waves, particles were oscillating and it was the energy transmitting. In the same manner, it is the energy, the flow of energy. But it is not due to the change, the oscillation of particle. Yahan par ho kya raha hai? Particle oscillate nahi kar raha hai. Yahan par ho raha hai ki energy intensity, or sorry, electric field intensity increase ya decrease ho rahi hai in such a manner ki उसके थोड़े से टाइम के बाद दिस इज एट टी इज इक्वल टू जीरो एंड दिस इज टी एट मे बी डेल्टा टी सम टाइम इंटरवल. तो यहां पर हुआ क्या कि इंटेंसिटी उसकी ऐसी वेरी की कि अभी शेप ऐसा लग रहा है कि उसने थोड़ा सा आगे मूव कर लिया है. दिस इज व्हाट वी आर कॉलिंग वेव, इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक वेव. एक्चुअली दिस इज इलेक्ट्रिक वेव, राइट? आई विल ड्रॉ अनदर ग्राफ फॉर यू टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट एग्जैक्टली इज एन इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक वेव. Intensity, yes. So this is a sinusoidal electric wave. Of course, you must be knowing by now what a sinusoidal wave means. Basically, you can represent wave in the form of this. E at any distance x is equal to E naught multiplied by sine omega t. Alright, now, अगर इसमें मैं क्या कह रहा हूँ ध्यान से सुनिए. This is the y-axis is electric field. Now I can draw another axis which is z-axis, right? Z-axis. Z. Now, just look into it. What I'm drawing over here is the magnetic field right now. अभी electric field हमने बना दिया था. But magnetic field looks something like this. You must be thinking what I have drawn. Just imagine this to be inside the plane and this is outside the plane. coming outwards. It means that if the electric field is in this moving in this direction, then magnetic field is actually moving in this direction. Alright. So this is what you have to imagine. This is B, or representing B, and this is representing E. They are both moving in the same x-axis. If you want to give you equation for B at any position x is equal to B naught, it is starting from the same thing, then I can also write sine omega t. But it is B in the z-axis, right? Z-axis, and this is y-axis. So they are both moving in tandem or in sync. There is just that one is propagating in the y-axis, another is propagating in the z-axis, and they are both moving towards the x-axis. This is what is a simplistic view or animation, slightly what you can say, of electromagnetic waves. Light is a form of electromagnetic wave. We'll talk about it, what are the different ranges of electromagnetic waves. But I think the notion of electromagnetic waves, you must be clear about that till now. Now, coming back to this mind map, we have this slight history that Heinrich Hertz was the first one to transmit radio waves. Radio waves is also one example of electromagnetic wave, through which we communicate via the radio. So it was done in 1886. It is a slightly factual thing. You do not need to remember, actually. The rest of the thing is important. Now, this I have already talked about. They are mutually perpendicular to each other, moving in the same direction. This is called electromagnetic wave. These are the things, underlying principles of electromagnetic wave. I'll talk about it in a brief manner. First of all, Gauss law. What is Gauss law? I have already talked about that in the electrostatic chapter, that let's say there is some charge around which I draw a surface over the area over which at all points the magnetic, let's say the electric field is already known, E, or there is some electric field which is constant over all this area. Then what you do is simply the electric flux E into ds over the integration, means the whole thing multiplied. Let's say you take this much amount of area and you take the electric field coming out of it. You multiply them and do the over the whole area, over a closed area, then it will be simply equal to Q enclosed divided by epsilon naught. Alright. So whatever charge is there inside the closed area, that is going to be Q enclosed, and epsilon naught is a constant that you already know, permittivity of space. So this is Gauss's law. In magnetism, it is a slightly different format. It is in the form of length. Why? Because let's consider a wire around which you take certain points which are having fixed magnetic strength due to the wire. It is going to be a ring, right? In this case, yes. And having a fixed magnetic field B in this fashion. If the current is flowing in this direction, then from the Fleming's right hand thumb rule, you already know that the current is in this direction. When the current is going, sorry, the magnetic field is in this direction when the current is going up. So, this thing, what you do is integrate it. B into not ds, dl further. So, if you take the integral, it will be simply I, mu naught I. And if you do it over an area, it is going to be zero. Why? Because it is a closed area. B dot ds, it is going to be 0. This is more important. Now we have Faraday's law. In the last or second last mind map, we already talked about Faraday's law, that it is, let's say, some area over which flux is changing. Let's say this is the coil that I'm talking about, having some resistance, and it is passing through certain area of having magnetic field, which is perpendicular to the area itself. Now, when it is in this direction, moving in this direction, then initially it is this amount of flux which is there, and after certain time, it has entered this much. So now this much amount of flux is there, right? Magnetic flux. Due to this change in magnetic flux, some EMF will be generated in the system. That we give by the Faraday's law is equal to minus d phi by dt, where minus represents that the resultant EMF is trying to oppose the cause. Basically, if the movement of this coil or the increase in flux is causing EMF, then this EMF will be in certain way or in such a way that it will try to decrease the flux. It will try to decrease the net flux. How it will do that? It will conduct the electricity in such a manner that, let's say, it conducts the electricity in this way, in the anti-clockwise way. Then you just apply the Fleming's right-hand thumb rule, and the flux will come outside, right? So the magnetic field is coming outside. It is actually trying to oppose the flux which is inside, right? Going inside. That is why the resultant current will be in the anti-clockwise direction. That is this Lenz law determines only the direction of the current. Direction. It is nothing to do with the strength. The strength you could find out easily with the help of Faraday's law. तो फैराडेज लॉ हो गया. अभी एम्पियर्स लॉ देखते हैं. एम्पियर्स लॉ इज नथिंग बट स्लाइट मॉडिफिकेशन दिस थिंग. या आई थिंक वी हैव ऑलरेडी टॉक्ड अबाउट इट. बी डॉट डी एल इज म्यू नॉट आई, बट समथिंग एल्स इज हैपनिंग. इफ बी इज चेंजिंग वेरिएबल, वट इज गोइंग टू हैपन? इट विल बी चेंजिंग द फ्लक्स एज वेल, वेरिएबल. एंड वेन phi changes, it gives you new EMF, right? EMF induced. And when EMF is induced, the current is also induced, some induced current. This induced current could be found out in the form of displacement current. If there exists electric current as well as changing electric field, they result into the magnetic field. Yes, of course. Magnetic field and cause displacement current. So this is the formula for displacement current. I displacement is equal to epsilon naught minus d phi e by dt. All right. This phi represents the flux. When you do this, you add this one here because it should be a net current, right? If the flux itself B is changing, then integral of B dl should not always only give you mu naught I as per our discussion, mu naught I, but also mu naught into the I displacement, right? I displacement. And what is I displacement? Epsilon naught is equal to mu naught I plus mu, what is that ID? Minus epsilon naught minus d phi by dt. This is the same thing written over here. So it is just that BDL that we usually did in the last chapter, it was a static thing. It was not changing with time, BDL. But when BDL itself changes with time, it gives rise to another form of current, which is called displacement current, which is the result of, I told you, right? B variable, then flux is variable, then induced EMF, and induced EMF will give you induced current, which itself, it is like a cyclical process. This changes, the second one also changes. Due to the second change, the first thing also tries to change. This is what induction was. In the previous class, we have already talked about, so we will not go into detail for that. Displacement current, we covered in this one. And all these laws, these are called Maxwell's laws. Although we have already talked about them in detail. Now, some of the properties, some of the characteristic properties of waves. First of all, it does not need a medium to propagate. First of all, what type of wave is this one? EM wave. There are two type of wave, right? Longitudinal wave and transverse wave. A transverse wave is in the manner that the oscillation is happening in the direction which is perpendicular to the direction of movement of wave. If the wave is moving in this direction, then the oscillation of whether the particle or whatever quantity is that, the oscillation is in the direction which is perpendicular to the direction of movement of the wave. Whereas in the longitudinal wave, the direction of movement of the particle or the whatever quantity is there, that is, it is in the same direction. For example, if you talk about sound wave, the particles oscillate in this direction itself. It oscillates in this way. And the direction of the wave is the rightward direction. That is why it is called longitudinal and this is transverse. So if this is clear, transverse wave, we are talking about some other property of the transverse wave, especially light wave or electromagnetic wave, in which, see, if this is a string, then the particles of the string oscillate in this way, right? That is why the wave flows in such a way. These are the particle, individual particles which are oscillating up and down. But what happens in EM waves, electromagnetic waves, I already told you, right? There is no particle inside it. If there is no particle inside it, then what is the carrier of the wave, right? It is simply the electric field strength and the magnetic field strength, which are the carrier of the wave, and they are the one responsible for the flow of wave. I already told you by this example that even if you see only the strength or the simpler curve or simpler graph of E versus X, if that changes with time, the graph does have some wave inside it, right? Wave. So that is why there is no need. If there is a particle needs some medium, right? A medium to flow. If there is no medium, particle cannot exactly flow. For example, if there is a sound wave, it needs to have air particles, right? Those are the ones which will vibrate. If there is no air particle inside the system, even if we generate sound from here, it will not reach here. Why? Because there is no particle which can conduct the flow of the wave. But in case of electromagnetic wave, there is no particle involved. There is no, the oscillation is not of the particle itself. Particle hai hi nahi. Matlab ki oscillation ke liye particle zarurat hi nahi hai. To fir vacuum mein bhi chal sakta hai na? Kyunki vacuum mein koi particle nahi hota. Alright. So this is the reason why you do not need any material or any medium to for the propagation of wave. Now there is this thing, speed of light. I will give you just this formula. C square is equal to 1 by under root. Sorry, C is equal to mu naught epsilon naught. It is just the relation between the permittivity of space. Permittivity of space and permeability of space. I hope you understand the difference between them from the previous classes. So there is a direct relation. Even if you, this is a pretty everybody remembers this, but sometimes confusion does happen between epsilon naught and mu naught. If you don't remember one of the values, then what you can simply do is C square is 1 by mu naught epsilon naught. If you don't remember the value of mu naught, let's say, then mu naught is simply 1 by C square epsilon naught. From this way, you can get the value of either of them. So this is the speed of electromagnetic wave, including the light. 1 by epsilon naught, mu naught, and the whole thing under root. Now, produced by accelerated charge, this is the production of the charge, or the production of the wave I'm talking about. We have, what is the source, common source of light on the earth or on any planet? This is sun, which is producing the light, right? Or the other stars. What is happening over inside the stars? Thermonuclear fusion. Thermonuclear fusion, right? In which atoms collide with each other and join to a, let's say it is having a 10 unit of mass, 10 unit of mass. Let's say it has a 19 unit of mass, then 1 unit of mass, where does it go? This 1 unit of difference of mass, difference of 1 unit, it goes into the form of energy. Then you'll say, how is it that mass is getting converted into energy? This is a Einstein's theory of relativity. Mass and energy are not different from each other. They are relatable. Mass can be converted into energy and energy can be converted into mass. And the relation between them is the famous equation E is equal to mc square, where c square is the square of speed of light. And let's say you have a loss of 1 unit of energy, 1 unit of mass, then the energy that is produced in that thermonuclear fusion will be simply E is equal to 1 unit, whatever unit that you have taken, m, the delta m into c square. This is the resultant of the energy that we receive from the sun or any star. You can say that source of all the energy in the world is simply thermonuclear fusion or fission. Fission is another type. We'll talk about it in the later chapter. So what we were discussing over here was, this property produced by accelerated charge. Now, you already know that inside the sun, there are hydrogen and helium atoms, right? Hydrogen atoms combine between them each other and produce helium. This is the basic reaction going on inside the sun, due to which while the charges are there inside the sun, they are accelerating due to the gain in energy due to the thermonuclear fusion. When they are gaining energy, they are accelerating, and as per Maxwell's theory, that when charges accelerate, they emit energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation. You might be remembering this from the criticism of Maxwell to Rutherford's atomic structure, that if it is moving in a circular orbit, it is basically accelerating, and when it is accelerating, the electron is accelerating, it should emit energy in the form of electromagnetic waves, and it will lose energy, due to which it should collide into the nucleus. But that doesn't happen, due to which the Rutherford's model was criticized. But we're looking in this way, that accelerated charges inside the sun are the reason why electromagnetic waves are created. First of all, how is it that an accelerating charge could create magnetic field or electric field? First of all, charges itself are responsible for creating electric field, right? So E is due to direct static charge as well. But when charges move, they produce magnetic field as well. Why? As we already talked about in the last chapter, that induced, right? When you have accelerating charges, that leads to formation of magnetic field. This has been discussed in the last mind map. Please refer to that. So transverse in nature, we already discussed about that. And oscillating electric and magnetic fields are in phase. I already told you, right? They're in phase. They always intersect each other at the nodes. They're not out of phase. Otherwise, it would not be an electromagnetic wave. And see, that is, there is a relation between the electric field intensity and the magnetic field intensity, is that the speed of light is simply E naught by B naught. This is the relation between electric field intensity and the magnetic field intensity of an electromagnetic wave. It is a fixed quantity, that is the speed of light. So if electric field is intensity is increasing inside an electromagnetic wave, the B should also increase proportionately, so that their ratio is constant, which is speed of light. So this has been discussed. Now coming to this part, let's talk about the energy. U is simply half epsilon naught E square. This is due to electric field. Alright. And energy, and this is not energy, it is energy density. What is energy density? Energy per unit volume. Energy per unit volume. If electromagnetic wave is passing through certain volume, then energy inside that that electromagnetic wave, it is a proportionate of volume, right? If it is over a bigger volume, then it is having a higher energy. And in the same manner, due to magnetic field or B, it is simply 1 by 2 B square upon mu naught. This is permittivity of space, and this is permeability of space. If you want to find out the total energy of the electromagnetic wave, EM wave, it is going to be simply half epsilon naught E square plus, at any instant I'm talking about, B square by epsilon naught. At any instant, for example, if you talk about this point, then whatever intensity is this one, you take E here, and whatever intensity is this one, you take B here, and you plug them in this equation, and you will find the energy density. Not energy, but energy density. Energy density. Now, what should be the average? What do you think? First of all, if you take the average of E over a certain point, let's say from here to here, then it is positive over a certain region and negative over a certain region. If add them up, there will be zero, right? E average is zero. But is E square average is zero? If you draw the graph of E square, it will look something like this. Not going down. Why? Because the square cannot be negative. It will be something like this. Okay. And the average of this will give you ERMS, right? ERMS, root mean square. We have already talked about in the AC part. What is root mean square? So the average value of E square can be found out in terms of root mean square. And we already talked about that root mean square of voltage was VRMS was simply V or V maximum divided by root 2. In the same manner, this is also sinusoidal wave. The sinusoidal wave is there. It is the property of sine waves, right? So even if it is intensity of electric field or magnetic field, it will not change. The property of the sine waves remain as such. That is why ERMS will be simply Emax divided by root 2. You just plug the value of this one over in this formula. Epsilon naught, and this is E maximum, right? Then it is going to be, what is that? If you take the average, then it will give you this much, 1 by 4 actually. Why? Because, just a second, because E maximum over root 2. If you talk about average, you will have to plug the value of E RMS, right? This is at any instant. If you want to find the average, then you will have to plug the value of E RMS, RMS for average. So E max, the whole thing squared plus half into B max upon root 2, that will be B RMS, the whole thing squared and mu naught. What do we get from here? Epsilon naught E max upon square 1 by 2. This is E naught, which is basically this value. This is E naught, right? And this value is B naught, the maximum intensity or the maximum crest. 1 by 2 epsilon min, yes, mu naught B naught squared over 2. What we got from here is 1 by 4 epsilon naught E square plus 1 by 4, sorry, not mu naught, it is 1 by mu naught B square upon mu naught. Alright, this is the energy density average. Not at any instant, it is the energy density average over a long time, of course. So this is the formula. I already talked about this one. You can even further, we can do that. E naught upon B naught, what was that? C, right? So let's convert this in format of, what was the format that they had taken? B naught square, okay, no problem. Any format we can take up. U average is equal to 1 by 4 epsilon naught E naught square into, C is equal to 1 by root mu naught E naught. I've already talked about this one. So let's just talk about E square by B naught square is equal to 1 by mu naught E naught, epsilon naught, sorry, right? So 1 by 4, let's take it here, and 1 by mu naught is equal to epsilon naught E naught square plus divided by B naught square. So let's do that. 1 by 4 into 1 by epsilon naught, right? This is the formula. 1 by 4 into 1 by epsilon naught. 1 by epsilon naught has the value of this one. 1 by mu naught, sorry. 1 by mu naught has the value of epsilon naught multiplied by E naught square, B naught square multiplied by B square. B naught square. B naught square gets cancelled out, and you're left with simply 1 by 4 epsilon E square, 1 by 4 epsilon square. Both added up will give you half epsilon naught E square. And it is also equal to half B naught square upon mu naught. In any form, you can write it. It means basically that the electric part, the E part, has the same energy density as the magnetic part. Both of them are equal and they contribute equally to the light energy, the energy inside the light. Now, we have all see this spectrum. Basically, I'll draw this spectrum for you. We have talked about frequency, right? Frequency and lambda, wavelength. So, any electromagnetic wave could be of any wavelength and any frequency. It could be very variable. For example, I'll draw this for you. A simple chart. What is the energy, lambda for visible light? It is simply from 3000 angstrom to 7000 angstrom. Or some people write it as 4000 angstrom. 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer is the visible range. If you increase the lambda, mu not decreases, right? Mu, which is the frequency. If the frequency decreases, the energy will also decrease. Which of the two has the lower energy? Infrared or ultraviolet? You know that ultraviolet rays are harmful. It basically means that it must have higher energy. So basically, this is the region of ultraviolet wave. UV, having lesser lambda. Lesser lambda means higher frequency, and higher frequency means more energy. And this is the region for infrared. Infrared. This is until, right? Infrared. This is until 10 to the power 5. And nanometer. Everything is in the form of nanometer here. And this is in the range of UV ray. UV rays in the form of 400 nanometer. Sorry. Yes. Or 10 nanometer actually. 10 nanometer. Not 400, because 400 is this much, right? Visible range. So 10 nanometer. If you have more intensity or more amount of energy, then you will have a further lesser lambda. That means this much is called X-ray. You must be knowing from the medical perspective that it is used for diagnostic purposes. And further having higher energy is the gamma rays. This has a property in the radiotherapy. In cancers, what they do is basically, if you have certain portions of cancerous tissue inside the body, they basically focus the laser having gamma rays to the tissue, and due to the very high intensity of energy inside the gamma ray, they get killed. And this is basically what chemotherapy is also, radiotherapy is also all about. Chemotherapy is different. It is about chemicals. They give different type, different chemicals inside the body to fight the cancer. So this is, I think, 0.01 nanometer. This is gamma ray. Further after that is gamma ray. And in that range, 0.01 nanometer to 10 nanometer is the X-ray. It is also slightly harmful for exposure. And further, if you give a higher lambda wavelength, then you get microwaves. Micro why? Because it is having slightly this thing. The application of microwave is in microwave induction. What happens is actually in microwave induction that the light has certain frequency that matches with the frequency of water, the vibrational frequency of the water molecule, due to which they get in resonance, and due to which due to the resonance some energy is transferred between the microwave to the water, due to which, because of both having same frequency of vibration. And the water vibrates further, due to which vibration leads to heating of the water. This is a microwave from this 10 to the power 5 nanometer to 10 to the power 8 nanometer. And from here, you have long, very long waves, which are called radio waves. Alright, so this is the basically spectrum, EM spectrum, electromagnetic wave spectrum. I think we are done for today. This was a relatively smaller chapter. So we'll meet in next one. Thank you.